Okay.
So today we'll discuss about some of the data center concepts as well as ISP networks. So as we know, we have basically what is meant by cloud and what is meant by data center. What is the basic difference between these two? So in general, in single term, we can call the cloud as everything as a service. Everything as a service in the sense, there is a common platform, there is a common set of services, and whatever the service we want, that service can be acquired on hired basis. That is pay and use. If you want to use memory and we need to pay something to use that memory, or if you want to use some resources which are commonly available, for that also we need to pay something. Let us assume that we have some room, okay, we have some room. This room is, we have per day 24 hours we have. Among these 24 hours, I am using only 1 hour. Let us assume that we are using that room only for 1 hour. And instead of kept idle remaining 23 hours, what I am doing is, I am accommodating various facilities in the same room based on the rent basis. That means what? For example, you want to use one room for 1 hour. I will give to you for on rent basis. Likewise, some other person may use the same room. Like that, the same room are accommodating for multiple facilities to use. To share the common resources by various persons, so that lot of money is saved, lot of time is saved, lot of effort is saved. So in the same way, if, for example, I will give one more example for you. For example, if one person want to travel from Adama to Addis Ababa for 1 day, let us assume that. What we are doing? There are three possibilities are there. Either we may share the common taxi, or we may hire separate vehicle, or we may purchase a separate vehicle to travel to Adama or Addis Ababa. Yes or no? So which is feasible for us? If we share the common taxi with other 15 or 16 people, that is very less. Yes or no? Very less. But we need to have some adjustment according to their timings. Yes or no? We need to travel just prior half an hour to travel time, and we need to wait there till my turn come. Then I will use the taxi, and after reaching Addis Ababa, again I need to hire one more taxi, like that. Or if you want to use more the services in more flexible manner, then we need to hire one taxi separately. Okay. So if it is common taxi, around 40 to 50 bur we can have. If it is, if you are hiring the taxi, around 1,000, 1,200, 1,300 we may have. If you purchase the taxi for one travel, just I want to go Addis Ababa for one time, for that there is no need of purchasing the taxi. Yes, sir? Right? That means somebody is hired for us, some taxi is hired for us, we are using the services from that facilities. Yes, sir? That means if there is a usage of less usage, or whatever the resources we have, whatever the memory we have, or whatever the processing we have, if you want to use the less amount of resources, then cloud is best. We have a common platform. From that, how much time you want, how much space you want, how much capacity you want, that we can hire from the cloud. Okay. Now, I want to go regularly, every day from Adama to Addis Ababa, I want to travel. In that case, we need to think of the wastage of time, so no, wastage of time and amount we are spending. And if I purchase the vehicle, how much time we are saving, and how much the probability of saved amount. Based on this, if you are frequent traveler, then we may purchase one vehicle. Yes or no? So, for ourselves, purchasing a vehicle is called data center. That means, if the usage is very less, we may have cloud. If usage is very frequent or more usage we have, then we may go for data center. Okay? So, apart from the data center as well as cloud, we have the difference between ISP networks as well as data center networks. In ISP network, we have the number of nodes as in hundreds. If you are connecting couple of hundreds of nodes, then we can call this as ISP networks. If we have more number of nodes or more number of servers or more number of storage devices in thousands, then we can call this as data center. Understood or not? Yes or no? Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. If we have the number of servers in the hundreds, then we can call it as ISP network. If the number of servers or number of nodes are in thousands, then we can call it as data center. For example, if you want to connect 30 to 40 systems within one single network, then we need to have one switch, and for that switch I am connecting all the multiple nodes into one single network. Yes or no? If we have 100 or more than 100, or if you have thousands, or if you have lakhs, then it is not possible to connect these bulky of systems within a single switch or within a multiple switch. We need to convert that topology into hierarchical topology, so that we are connecting multiple set of systems in hierarchical manner. So instead of that, instead of, if number of nodes are increasing, means what? The hierarchy is also increasing. So if hierarchy is increasing, it is impossible for us to manage. That not that much easy to manage. So that's why, instead of having multiple storage devices which are connected in hierarchical manner, what we are doing is, we are combining all the storage devices into one single room, and we are interconnecting all these storage devices as a network. Understood or not? Okay. For example, here we have 30 PCs are there. Each PC is having 1 TB of memory. Let us assume that. So how much data we can store in this room? 30 systems are there. 30 TB of data we can store. Yes or no? And when we transfer the data, let us assume that we have stored the 30 TB of data in distributed manner. Let us assume that. Some data in one system, some data in some other system, some data in some other system, like that. If we store like that, when we are sharing or when we are acquiring the data from each and every individual node through the intranet, so it may take more time. Yes or no? So that's why, to overcome that problem, what we are doing is, we are storing all the data in one single storage location. That storage location may have multiple storage devices which are interconnected, which are connected to one device to another device. So the basic problem here is the cost. How much we are spending to store 30 terabytes of data in each and every individual 30 systems. Okay. And how much we need to spend to store same 30 terabytes of data in one single memory location. So the cost may vary based on our requirement, what is the size of data we are going to store, and how many devices we are interconnected. Like, based on that, the cost may vary. So if we consider the breakdown, what the cost required, the servers, if it is 100, the 45% of the cost required for the servers, like processor and storage memory and some other subsystems or some other hardwares. 25% for infrastructure, that is power distribution and cooling system, and 15% for electrical, and 15% for networking, that is equipment. If you want to establish one data center, we need to have electrical engineer, we need to have mechanical engineer, we need to have network engineer, we need to have computer engineer. So these four persons are required, or these four fields of persons are required to establish a data center network. Why? To make the power supplies, or to make connecting the generators to the servers, we need to have electrical engineer. And mechanical to make generators, sufficient number of generators, and to fix the generators, and to make cooling systems, mechanical engineers are required. To perform interconnections, we need to have network engineers are required. To design protocols to measure the performance of that particular system, computer engineers are required. Like that, combination of these four may have the data center. So usually what we are saying is, previously in previous days, a complete data center is located in one single location. Let us assume that if we consider the complete globe as one data center, let us consider the example for Google or Facebook or YouTube. If we consider any one of these large size companies or industries, then if we place all the data in one single location, again transmission is become problem. Is that right? If all the data is available in USA, from wherever you want to access, the data should be coming from the server which is located in USA. Is that right? Again, the bandwidth consumption becomes more, and the time to transmit the data becomes more. So that's why what usually the large size companies are doing is, instead of having all the data in one single location, again they are distributing geographically based on the requirement, based on the continent wise or based on the country wise, our data is distributed and placed in various locations so that the bandwidth consumption will be reduced. Is that not? For example, we have one data center in Africa. Let us assume that. So usually 90% of data accessed by Africans itself, from the African data center. Is that not? For example, one more data center is available in New Zealand. Let us assume that. YouTube, let us consider. So when we access the videos as well as the audios, so usually our regional will give more preference for the regional languages. Is that not? Is that not? So how many of you are accessing the YouTube videos which are not related to your language, or not related to your continent, or not related to your region? Very less percentage. Is that not? So that's why if we divide the storage of data based on geographical locations, so that the bandwidth consumption will be reduced and the streaming problems are also we may overcome. So that's why, so instead of having all the related data in one single location, they are divided based on the geographical locations. That is one strategy. Now So as we said, now a cloud will be treated as everything as a service. If you want hardware, we can acquire the hardware as a service. If you want the storage as a service. This is a common platform where all these services are available. So what category of service you want, what sort of service you want, that service will be acquired from this particular common location. Let us give one more example for us. Let us discuss one example. For example, we have a dedicated leased line. Okay, we have a dedicated leased line. Let us assume my capacity is 100 Mbps. Or let us assume 4 GB dedicated capacity line is there. Let us assume that. For this lab, we have 4 GB of dedicated line. So that, let us assume our lab timings are morning 8 to 8 p.m. 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. That means, whatever the users we have in this lab, that users may access or may use that 4 GB of dedicated line from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. Then, after 8 p.m., before 8 a.m., who will use that bandwidth? Nobody is using. Yes or no? That means the bandwidth becomes waste. So that's why what I am doing is, what there is a possibility is, from 8 p.m. or 8:01 p.m. to 7:59 a.m., I am giving these bandwidths to some other purpose, or which can be used by some other persons or some other lab, so that whatever the resources we have, that resources are fully utilized, or the utilization becomes maximized by the resources. Understood or not? So yes or no? Yes. So cloud means there is a common platform. Based on our requirement, we may hire some space or hire some hardware components or hire some platform or hire some software. So let us take one more example. I think you heard about Amazon Cloud. Yes or no? Amazon Cloud. So this is, I think you can see this. These are based on the platform, whether you are the user of Windows or the user of Linux. Based on that, this is the cost per hour. If you are the Windows user, for this particular service, you need to pay this amount of dollars per hour. If you are the Linux user, for one particular service, there is a cost like that. So we can Google it, Amazon cloud, web cloud, web-based cloud. So in that cloud, we can have any service you want. That for that, we need to pay that for that particular service, and we need to use that service monthly, or hourly, or yearly basis payments are there. So based on that, we can have that particular service through the web. Like, another example for this cloud is Google App Engine. So, whatever the service we want, no need to acquire any hardware or any software. And if we have Google App Engine and simply write an application based on our requirement and then post it, upload it into that particular App Engine, so that with the help of APIs available with the Google, our application will be uploaded in that web page. So from this is the perspective from the developer. If I am the developer, I need to write an application and I need to use appropriate Google API and deploy the application into that App Engine. If you are writing an application, the Google has to provide these set of services for us. What are the services? Manage a data center. That is, they need to check whether the appropriate storage is available for that or not. Then all machines execute the App Engine at runtime. Deploy apps from the customers. Load balancing incoming, that is, how many requests are coming, how many requests have to be answered by that particular App Engine. And scale up the customer apps as needed. Execute multiple instances of that particular app. They need to, before, after deploying, they need to check the capacity of each and every app which was uploaded by us. So let us have some internal structure of a data center. So if you consider this, these are all set of racks. Okay. So inner view of that particular racks, we can see the cables connected for each and every rack. That means rack means one rack we have, in that some set of servers we have. Okay, all servers are placed in that particular rack, and these servers are internally connected with TOR, top of rack. So on top of rack we have a switch. That switch is connected to all the internal servers we have in that particular rack. And this is the Google data center top view. These are all top of racks and servers. Okay, and these are cooling systems. Cooling system to make the room cool. I think it is visible. To make the room cool, these are all cooling systems, and these are all servers. And in these racks, we have servers. On top of the rack, we have a switch, and that switch is connected to all the servers. Likewise, one server is having one switch. How many racks we have on the top of the rack? We have each and every rack is having one switch, and that switch is connected to all the individual servers. And this is the cooling plant. Whatever the size of data center may be half of that particular cooling system. So if we have 100 square meters of data center, the cooling system should be more than double the data center, that is more than 200 square meters of that particular system. Why? Because if we have one single system, we may have so much of heat produced. So this is not temporary running, no. Continuously that systems are running. So if you go inside the data center, then we may get so much of heat. For that, to extract the heat from this room, we need to have cooling systems. So now, so previously the case is, whatever the data center we are designing, each and every individual components like cabling, servers and hardware part and connectors, whatever the equipment we need, all these equipment we need to purchase individually, separately, and that has to be assembled to form a data center. But nowadays most of the companies, what they are doing is simply that this is called modularized data center. That means what? Everything is inside only. Servers are inside, connectivity is there, cooling system is there, and managed switches are there, automated connectivities are there. So everything inside this, simply they will move to the required place to locate that. So this is the data, modular data center of SGI and Huawei, HP, like that. So based on the requirement, again, these data centers may have various sizes. These data centers may have various sizes. For example, if small means what? That should consume less than 1 megawatt and 4 racks per unit. We have 4 racks, and each rack may have some set of servers. If it is medium, the consumption is 1 to 4 megawatts, 10 racks per unit. If it is large, it has more than 4 megawatt of power consumption, 20 racks per unit. See, if you consider the power consumption is 1.02. That means what? The actual power used by the systems or units or servers is only 0.02 megawatt. Remaining 100 megawatt is for cooling system. If that particular data center consumes 1 or 2 megawatts of power, only 2 megawatts per the servers to run the servers, and remaining 100 megawatts per cooling system. Okay, so that will be measured based on PUE, that is power in or power used, how much power it is used and how much power it is in. This is one sort of modular data center. And another category of data center is
this name was listed here. Containerized data center, not modularized.
Containerized means we can move the data center from one place to another place, which is like modularized but ready to use.
So we are building the data center in one location and placing the data center or containerized data center wherever we want with the help of other equipment that which can be placed in there. So which is ready to use, like modularized, everything is built in. So built-in cooling, easy to scale and suitable for disaster recovery, where earthquakes as well as floods have occurred, there also we can use these sort of data centers. So offered by Cisco, IBM, SGI, Sun Microsystems, Oracle, all these are using these sort of containerized data center.
Now, so we are saying data center means multiple servers. We have a large number of servers are there, storage devices are there. So all these storage devices are connected internally, interconnected with each other. And when we interconnect, see, for example, if we have three servers, we need to interconnect means what? One is connected with two, one is connected with three. Yes or no? 2 is connected 1, 2 is connected with 3. 3 is connected with 2, 3 is connected with 1. If we have 3 servers, how many connections are required? 3 connections are required. Yes or no? If we have 5 servers, how many connections are required? 1 with 2, 1 with 3, 1 with 4, 1 with 5. 2 with 1, 2 with 3, 2 with 4, 2 with 5, like that. So we will see that. So this is the basic topology of data center in which multiple storage devices are interconnected, multiple nodes are interconnected. So here, let us assume this is a complete data center. This is internal structure and outside these core switches are connected to internet. We are dividing the data center into three layers: layer 1, layer 2 and layer 3. Layer 1, layer 2 and layer 3. See, the layer 1 is below layer. We have layer 2 and layer 2 and 3 interface and layer 3. These layer 3 switches are connected to this particular internet. From the internet, we have a connections for this layer 3, we can call this as core routers or core switches. Then from this, we have layer 2, 3 interfaces. From this, instead of connecting directly to the switch, what we are doing is, we are using intermediate switches called layer 2 and 3, and we can call this as aggregation switches. From core switches to core router to aggregation switches to access switches. This access switch is connected to rack. How many racks we have, that racks are connected. Now, in this architecture also, for we will see that. So, here we have a set of servers and we have a top of rack here. This switch is connected to access switch. Access switch is in turn connected to aggregation. Aggregation in turn connected to core switches. This is the internal topology of the data center, the process which the nodes are connected. For example, see, here we have an internet. We are accessing the data from the internet, but in turn, that internet is connected to the data center. Okay? Here, as we said now, core switches, the core routers. Core routers is connected to the campus core net core switches. These are connected to servers. We have distribution, no? How many buildings are there? And each and every building is having one server. So then campus access, then we are accessing from the user, from the inside the campus. So likewise, the internal data center or internal structure of a data center, we don't know how the switches are connected and how the data will be shared among them, or when we are storing, in which server or in which storage device our data is storing, we don't know. Okay, from outside when we are accessing, this is the structure. What are the problems with common data center topology? See here, if we have 5 switches or 5 servers, one is connected with remaining 4, second one is connected with also remaining 4, third is also connected with remaining 4, fourth is also the remaining 4, fifth is also remaining 4. That is 5 into 4, 20 connections are required. Is that right? 20 connections are required. So instead of having 20 parallel connections for one particular switch or router, what we are doing is, we are structuring the arrangement of these servers inside the data center. What we are doing, instead of having 5 parallel connections, I am keeping multiple servers in one rack, I am keeping another set of servers in another rack, I am keeping another set of servers in another rack. Likewise, we are arranging the servers in structured manner, okay, so that with this cabling also we don't have any problem, or we are not going to face any problem with the cabling system also. Why? Because we are talking about only 5 servers, 20 connections are required, 20 cables are required. If we have thousands of servers, how many connections are required? So we don't able to find which cable belongs to which connection. So for that, we need to make that into structured manner. If any, the problem with basic topology is single point of failure, we can call that as. That means what? If any particular single server failed or single connection failed, then that branch of systems may not work. So yes or no? So for that, we have the solutions called one, whatever the design we are doing, that should be compatible with existing infrastructure. We are changing the topology means we are not changing all the hardware components. We are using the same hardware components, but the arranging structures we are changing, and we also added support of layer 2 with the help of Ethernet, and that should be cost effective in terms of less power has to be consumed, at the same time heat emission methodology and cheap infrastructure we need to have. It allows host communication at line speed, so that without changing any hardware, with the same hardware we are doing some restructuring in topology changes. Okay, we have, based on the number of servers we have, the switch cost may be vary. These are the manufacturer names, and these are power consumed, and these are data transmission. So the cost, power per GBPSU, to transfer 1 gigabyte per 1 gigabyte of data, how much power we need to have, and how much heat it is producing to transfer 1 GBPS data. So based on that, the cost may vary from size to size. So as we said now, inside the data center we have layer 2, layer 2 and 3 interface. In between layer 2 and layer 3 we have interface, and then layer 3. What operations are we are doing in layer 2 as well as layer 3? So in layer 2, it is responsible for spanning tree for entire network, okay, and it prevents looping. As we know, spanning tree is nothing but it should not form a loop. Okay, for example, 1 is connected with 2, 2 is connected with 3, 3 is connected with 4, 4 is again connected with 1. Let us assume that here loop is forming. So whatever the connection strategy we have,
that connection strategy should not have the loops. Then ignores any alternate paths. As we said now, as we said earlier, if we have multiple routes from source to destination, okay, if we have multiple routes from source to destination, in that case, they, if you have multiple paths, among them one path has to be selected, remaining paths has to be ignored. And in layer 3, it is responsible for shortest path routing between the source as well as the destination, and best effort delivery. At maximum speed, the data has to be delivered to the destination. So now, what are the various categories of topologies we have till now? This is called conventional topology. The earlier topology. Here we have an internet, as we said earlier in previous example. These are curve routers we have. These curve routers are connected with aggregation switches. Aggregation switches are connected with access layer. So this is the basic one. But if you observe the connections between core routers and aggregation switches, see, first core router is connected with remaining all aggregation switches. Here we have four aggregation switches are there. First core router is connected with all four aggregation switches. Second core router is also connected with all four aggregation switches. And then here the first aggregation switch is connected again with all top of racks, and second one is also connected with all top of racks. Likewise, this side also we have seen. So the problem with this is, whatever the cabling system we have, it may have, if the number of levels are increased, the number of connections become more and it may become complex to access the data. So to overcome this problem, we have another topology called class topology. So instead of previously, we have the switches in two levels. One is aggregation switch, second one is access switch below the core routers. Aggregation switch is there and access switch is there. Instead of having the aggregation one level, access one level, what we are doing is, we are connecting the switches in various layers. If you have 12 switches, in previous case what we did, in parallelly we connected, in blockwise we connected, and here in layer 1, layer 2, layer 3, or stage 1, stage 2, stage 3. If we have 12 switches are there, these are arranged in 3 rows and each one is connected with various next layer. Whatever the switches we have in the next level, with all the switches, the upper layer is connected with. Again, here also the number of connections may not be reduced. So for that, we have another topology called flat tree based topology. So here, for example, I am considering k is equal to 2. Here k is nothing but, for example, k array flat tree. We are constructing a tree based topology for the switches we have. So if k is equal to 2 means we are arranging in 2 layers. K is equal to 3 means we are arranging in 3 layers. Understood or not? 4 means 4 layers we are arranging. K is equal to 2 means only 2 layers we are arranging, and this was connected with this switch and this one, this one, this one. Likewise, how many are there? How many applications which blocks are there? For each and every block, it will be connected, and from them, these four are internally connected. These are not connected with the other one. That means what? From this, it has to route the data, route the packet or data into appropriate aggregation switches. disaggregation switch may in turn connected with other three, and for this we have the top of racks. Understood or not? Yes or no? So we can see the lines how it was connected. And if it is K array switch or K array factory, each pod consisting of K by 2 whole square servers. Pod means this one. Each pod consisting of K by 2 power 2 servers and two layers of K by 2 K port switches. We are K is equal to 2 we are taking, so that's why two layers of K port switches. And then each edge switch connects to K by 2 servers and K by 2 aggregation switches. K by 2 servers and K by 2 aggregation switches, 2, 2. Each aggregation switch consisting of K by 2 edge and K by 2 core switches and K by 2 whole square core switches, each connected to K ports.
That is the terminology. If you are understanding, okay, otherwise leave it, no problem. So the basic advantage of these designs are, especially cost will be reduced. So instead of having one-to-one connection, we are arranging the switches in a hierarchical manner, in structured manner, so that this will become cheap. So if we have
whatever the individual components that are no need for custom servers for network, custom servers or networking kit, and sort of easy to scale horizontally, if you want we can expand that, and runs, use it to run the standard software like not cluster computing and grid computing are not required, and stock networking protocols and virtual machines are also possible to establish.
If you want to have memory virtually, you can create virtual memory. If you want to have the device, any device virtually, you can have virtual device. So these are the various problems we have. The similar kind.
Now, so in layer 3, we want to do some modifications so that it can perform the shortest path IP routing will typically use only one path despite the diversity in the topology. If we have any change in the topology, then it has to find the shortest path only. Even if we change the topology also, the probability of getting the shortest path is high with IP routing. And if using equal cost multipath routing at each and every switch independently and blindly, packet reordering may occur. That is, reordering means what? If you have three packets, 1, 2, 3, the packets are not delivered in the sequential order. That is, first packet, 1 has to be delivered, 2 has to be delivered, 3 has, not like that. If you have 3 packets, randomly any packet, either third packet may reach first, or second packet may reach first, or the first packet may reach first. Randomly, it may reach to that destination. Further, load may not be necessarily be well balanced. That is, if you have, as we see the previous structure, only core routers are connected to the internet. Okay, only core routers are connected to the internet. That means what? That core routers has to manage the complete internal structure of the data center. How many servers we have? Thousands of servers we have. All these servers are maintained by the core routers only. For that, to reduce the load on that particular routers, we have a concept called load balancer. Load balancer means what? How many core routers are there? How many aggregation switches are there?
how many access switches are there and what is the maximum capacity they can have. So if that particular capacity exceeds, means the load balancer has to manage the things or divert the transmission to another one. So for that we modify the topology of FAT3, especially in IP addressing scheme which we are using in data center. So that is unused port number, switch number and host. This is the ID which we given for that particular switch, unused port number dot, switch number dot and host. So like this, 10.2.0.0 allows host attached to same switch to route only through the switches, allows inter-port traffic to stay within that particular port. Here we are adding in IP, where we added two levels, one is called prefix and second one is called suffix. What they will do? The first level is prefix lookup, which can be used to route the data into the topology of the servers, and the second level is called suffix lookup, which can be used to route towards the core. That means what? From top to bottom we are using prefix lookup, from bottom to top we are using suffix lookup, which will maintain packet ordering by use same ports for the same servers. From core switch to servers we are using suffix prefix lookup, from servers to core routers we are using suffix. So the same. So another approach in data center is called monsoon approach. So again the structure is same. It has the hierarchy as represented as 2, which is having the access switches called top of racks as well as load balancing switches, as we said now, to reduce the overhead on the core routers, then we are having the load balancing switches. So which will eliminate the spanning tree and prevent MAC address learning, support efficient grouping of hosts virtually created with the physical one. So for the previous structure, remaining all are same except we are adding load balancers. Based on our requirement, we are adding load balancers. This is layer 2, this is layer 3 and this is internet. So here we have an interface, layer 2, 3 interface called aggregation switches. Then for this, layer 3 is connected with aggregation switches connected with load balancers and access. So these load balancers are mainly used to check the load on each and every individual router or each and every individual switches. So how much load it may have or what is the maximum capacity of that particular device and how much load we have. If load exceeds, then it may divert the data, divert the traffic into another area. So these are the components like other architectures, monsoon comp, these are the components we have: top of rack switch, intermediate switch, decision element and host. So how the routing will be worked? So we have a monsoon agent. This is under layer 2 TCP IP, encapsulation has to be done. Network interface card we have, and it will resolve the IPs of remote devices. Forwarding. So now, as we said now, this is the internet we have. This will be connected to the front end servers or core routers, we can call this as, and for this, this will become the backend.
In backend, we have set of multiple set of servers are there. All these are connected to core switches or core routers. These are connected to the internet, and from where we are accessing that the data will be accessed from the data center structure.
And these are the key challenges.
We have thousands of servers within a data center, and the challenge is how to write an application or how to acquire the service from them, how to allocate resources as well as manage them, and scale and complexity bring other key challenges. With thousands of machines, failures are default case. Usually when we have more than thousands of servers, then there is a possibility of failures, load balancing, handling, as well as heterogeneity. We have various kinds of servers in that case. How we are going to handle that? And supercomputer as well as cluster computer.
I think no need to explain this. So let us consider some case studies,
not in brief, just for you. Google File System. In Google File System, when we have Google a file, corresponding file, from where it is coming? In Google, how many files are there? How much data we have in this Google? So a file system for a cluster computer or on top of native operating systems on individual machines. So designed with certain types of applications in mind and designed with failures as the default cases. That means what? When we search a particular word, what it will display? It will display some thousands of results. Yes or no? It will display some thousands of results. On what basis? On the matching score for a word given by us. If we have three words, it will check individually first word, then in how many files that word is available, it will display that results. Second word, third word, like that. In some cases, if we have three words, then if one word is missing in one file, then it will show the result. In the bottom of that, it will show this particular word is missing, like that.
So MapReduce, for example, I want to reduce the number of results displayed by the Google. In that case, we have some filtering mechanisms
called MapReduce, which is a programming paradigm for certain types of applications in Google file system. And other examples include Bigtable, Amazon, Google Jabber, and open source systems like Hadoop.
So these are also used to store the data in large manner.
So this is the cluster divided by the Google. So this is, we have a schedule master, and we have a look service master, and we have file system master, Google file system master. In machine 1, we have this set of components. In machine 2, we have this set of components. In machine 3, we have this set of components. If the burden becomes more for any machine, for that particular machine, one more virtual machine will be created in turn. Based on the load we have on that particular machine, the number of virtual machines may be created for each and every individual system. So architectural design, MapReduce.